You just empty me, Father God, and wipe this vessel clean, Father God, so that I may bring your word, Father God, whatever your message is, Father God, that you would speak this morning, Father God. And so, Lord, right now, Father, and we just ask that you open up our hearts, Father God, open up our eyes and our minds, Lord God, to whatever that you have for us, Lord God. Because we know, Father God, when we follow you, nothing can return void, Father God. And so we thank you this morning, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. Again, my name is Minister Zach, for those of you that don't know me. Those online, hello, good morning. You know, if you haven't heard any of my sermons, I tend to go a little personal, just because it's me, that's who I am. I kind of like to put it out there because, you know, privately, I'm pretty introverted. I don't really share a lot of stuff to people and stuff. So, you know, I don't come off the most relatable. I have that resting face that looks always mad. And so, if I'm sitting there, it looks like I'm mad, but I'm really not. I really just like, you know, I'm just sitting there, like not thinking about anything, you know. Naturally, I'm not like the most charismatic, like Minister Anthony or Minister Marvin. And so, you know, if I'm sitting there, just say hi. I'm not trying to be mean or anything. That's just my face. I'm sorry. But, my whole family's like that. My mom looks always like she's mad. And I guess that's where it comes from. But she's not, for the most part, unless I do something wrong. But once you get to know me, I'm pretty goofy. I'm really nerdy. As you'll know when we go into my sermon a little bit. So I would like to share with you guys one of my favorite songs ever, just so you guys get to know me a little bit more, a little bit different side of me. You're going to think, like, why are you playing this song? But there's a reason. I always do something for a reason. So it's just one of the genres that I'm drawn to. So if you wouldn't mind playing my song, you know, everyone gets to play their... R&B songs. Come on, pump it up. Come on, pump it up. I want to get my time too, you know what I mean? Yeah. Woo. Yeah. I'm gonna try not to cry, I promise. Long ago, I am the chosen, I'm the one. Yeah. And I will leave until I'm done.
So that's why you got the time. You got the breathing out the fun. So I'm not playing, I play this game. And I won't stop until I'm done.
But what I really want to know is, are you gonna go my way? And I've got to know. Yeah. This is my jam in the car. And rearrange
and turn this planet back to one. So tell me why we got to try and give each other one by one. We got to love
and rub a dub.
We got to dance and be in love.
But what I really want to know is, are you gonna go my way? Hold on, this is the best part. This is the best part right here. Yeah. Yeah. That's where it is. That's where it is. All right. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Woo! All right, you can turn it down. You can turn it down. Amen. Amen. Just a little bit about me, because I do enjoy a little rock sometimes. Eh, you know, not quite the hymnals that we're used to, so. Just a little background on the song. Let me go to my slides. We're going to do the Bible today. Amen. This is the song, Are You Gonna Go My Way, by Lenny Kravitz. Lenny Kravitz, half Jewish and half Bahamian. His mother was from the Bahamas. Roxy Roker, yes. If you don't know who she was the neighbor on the Jeffersons. When I first heard this song in 1993, okay, that's, I know, dating myself a little bit. I hated it. I thought this was dumb because of the circumstances that I heard it. Okay, my brother, you know, my cousins were in town, and my brother's like, hey, Zach, you want to go with me to the store? And so he brought me to Sam Goody's. I don't know if you guys remember Sam Goody. I think it's either Sam Goody or the warehouse. I forget. And so he's like, I just want to go buy something real quick. I'm like, oh, fine, that's fine. And so we go there, and we're there for like hours. And it's like, you know, I'm 13 years old, and like, what is going on? Like, it's like he's shopping for shoes or something. Like, I was just so frustrated. And so I had a bad attitude. He's like, yo, man, this is the jam. You know, and so I go on our way home. I'm just stomping my feet and like, you know, just all mad and angry. And we were listening to this song on the way home, and I was like, we spent hours for this? That's crazy. And so we get up to the house, and then I realize he was just stalling because they were throwing me a surprise party for my 13th birthday. And so I kind of felt like a jerk for being mad. Plus, my brother and I, like, we don't get along very much, like, back then, because he used to, you know, he's my older brother, always pick on me. But we had this massive party, and now my jerk brother, I love him to death. And he introduced me to this song. And until recently, I didn't realize that this song is actually a Christian song. Lenny Kravitz had authored this song because his mother was a devout Christian. And so he wrote this in the eyes of Jesus. And, you know, it really blew up in the 90s, and he used this platform to talk about who Jesus is without actually having to say Jesus. You know, and if you go on this album, the next song is called Believe, and he talks about believing in God. And I was just kind of in shock because I never realized that. I know the song came out in 1993, but I didn't know that until I was saved afterwards. And I'm like, oh man, this song has, there's something to this song that I didn't realize. But this song went, in 1993, really like skyrocketed Lenny Kravitz. It went number one on the rock charts, and it was on MTV, what is that called? I forgot what it was called, but when they used to show videos, it was like one of the ones they always showed. And around the entire globe, it went number one in Australia, and so he used his platform to talk about who Jesus is. And so our message for today is, are you going to go God's way? And just so a little bit of background for what we're going to be talking about, we're going to go to Acts chapter 16, if you guys want to get there. Right before 16, Paul and Barnabas had kind of just went around. They did their first missionary journey. It was about a year-long missionary journey where they went around Asia. And when they were in Asia, they planted all these churches. And so the plan was for them to go and visit all these churches to uplift these churches that they planted. And so
But Paul and Barnabas, they got in a little argument about John Mark, and so they went their separate ways. And so Paul took Silas, and he took Timothy, and then that's where we're at in chapter 16. Amen? Everyone there? All right, my man, William, is going to read for us the voice.
Acts 16, verse 1. Paul and Silas, I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Paul and Silas went first to Derbe and then on to Lystra. There they met Timothy, a young disciple whose mother was a Jewish believer, but whose father was a Greek. Timothy was well thought of by the believers. In Lystra and Iconium, so Paul wanted him to join them on their journey. In deference to the Jews of the area, he arranged for Timothy to be circumcised before they left, for everyone knew that his father was a Greek. Then they went from town to town explaining the decision regarding the commandments that were to be obeyed, as described by the apostle and elders in Jerusalem. So the churches were strengthened in their faith and grew daily in numbers. Next, Paul and Silas traveled through the area of Phrygia and Galatia, because the Holy Spirit had told them not to go into the province of Asia at that time. Then coming to the borders of Mysia, they headed for the province of Bithynia. But again, the Spirit of Jesus did not let them go. So instead, they went on through Mysia to the city of Troas. That night, Paul had a vision. He saw a man from Macedonia in northern Greece pleading with him, "Come over here and help us." So we decided to leave for Macedonia at once, for we could only conclude that God was calling us to preach the good news there. 11. We boarded a boat to Troas and sailed straight across to the island of Samothrace. And the next day we landed in Neapolis. From there we reached Philippi, a major city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We stayed there several days. On the Sabbath, we went a little way outside the city to a riverbank where we supposed that some people met for prayer, and we sat down to speak with some women who had come together. One of them was Lydia from Thyatira, a merchant of expensive purple cloth. She was a worshiper of God. As she listened to us, the Lord opened her heart, and she accepted what Paul was saying. She was baptized along with other members of her household, and she asked us to be her guests. "If you agree that I am faithful to the Lord," she said, "come and stay at my home." And she urged us until we did.
Amen. Amen. So what we're going to be talking about today is really Paul's second missionary journey. See, originally his plan was for him to stay around Asia and then go up to Bithynia and Mysia. But we see here that wasn't really God's plan. See, their purpose was to spread the gospel. And as we learned this morning, as we just saw, that's pretty much everyone's responsibility, right? In Matthew 28, it tells us all of us, we should go. And some of the things that we see here, but these are the things that we're going to be talking about today, that God has given each of us a mission. And what we're going to read and what we've read here is that we need to be sensitive to the Spirit of God. And
when we're obedient to what God has told us to do, it brings yields to the harvest. Amen? And so that's what we're going to be discussing this morning. So the first thing is that God has given us a mission, the Great Commission. It's everyone's responsibility. What Paul is doing here is that Paul and Timothy and Silas, they were going to go and just encourage the churches and help these churches grow, which is something that we all should do, right? Each one of you has a responsibility to help this church grow, yes? And so because they had planted, it was early in the, they wanted to just support them any way that they can. And their presence was a way that they can support them and help them, learn about who God is, what the rules are, and because it was all new. This was all the beginning of the church, amen? And one of these things is that what Paul had to do in order for this mission to be accomplished was he had to make it so they didn't have to run into any of these issues that really had no meaning. And what they did was Timothy ends up getting circumcised. Did he have to get circumcised? No, he did not have to. But because they were going to meet with Jewish folks, that was the original intent, was to go meet with, they didn't want that to be an issue. And so that was their outward expression. We talked about circumcision this morning in Sunday school, which you guys should have been there, just saying. This was their outward expression to show that they were the chosen people. Amen? And so Timothy, a grown man, decides to get circumcised. And I don't know about you, but when you're a baby, you probably won't remember what happened. But as a grown man, you know exactly what's going to happen to you. Amen? And so Timothy was preparing himself to go on this mission. He decided to cut off his junk a little bit. But by doing this, he becomes a more effective witness for Christ. So no one can just talk about, oh, he's part Greek. But he's trying to show and relate to people, wherever they're at. And this becomes a non-issue for them. So this was his way of preparing himself. Does that make sense? 1 Corinthians 9:22 says, to the weak, I became weak. To win the weak, I have to become all things to all people so that by all possible means, I might save some. And that's what Timothy was doing here. We got to be relatable to folks. If we're not relatable to folks, how can we minister to them? How can we talk to them? And they know us and why would they want to get to know us if we're not relatable to them? And so we have to have that same attitude. We have to do whatever it takes to reach the lost. Sometimes reaching the lost may be doing something out of your comfort zone so that people may be reached. I mean, can you imagine Timothy going through this procedure? I have a friend who, her family, is from the Philippines, and her brother was not circumcised as an infant. And so on his 12th birthday, the dad was like, son, it's time for you to get circumcised. So uncle and dad took him to the bathroom and did it for him. They're from the Philippines, so I don't know
like they're from old school folks, and all he heard was screaming. So it's crazy. So just think about that, okay? Think about that. Timothy went through this whole situation just so he can minister to others. What are you willing to do so that you can minister to others? Are you willing to get out of your comfort zone and do something that is not you, to talk to someone who doesn't look like you, who doesn't sound like you, who doesn't eat like you? Because that the 13 that were up here, that's what they're doing. So we have to make sure that we have this mindset where we are looking towards, okay, God has given us a mission to go reach the lost. What does that look like for you? And what does that look like for your preparation to reach that person? Because honestly, we have, I know each of us that have claimed that we're saved, God has put in your heart somebody that needs a talking to, that needs Jesus in their life, that is lost. And we should have this mindset where it kills us to know that if they die tomorrow, they're not going to be there when you go see the Savior. You know, I believe it was Charles Spurgeon who had this, who was looking, he was with a whole bunch of pastors, and he was in a building looking out the window, and he just started crying. C.S. Lewis. And he just started crying. And they're like, what's wrong? It's like, all these people out there, you know, who aren't saved, are going to go to hell. Every time we drive through this valley, we should have that same mindset. Do these people know who Jesus Christ is? The coworkers that we love and we see on a daily basis, do we have that mindset and that heart to reach them and say, man, you know, do you know who Jesus is? Would you like to know who he is? And we have to learn how to approach that, how to approach folks to talk about who Jesus is. I mean, everyone should be part of the evangelism class. Everyone should sit with Minister Phil, because we need to be prepared to be able to talk to people about Jesus Christ. Second Timothy 4:2 says, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with complete patience and teaching. I know this one is talking about ministers, but we all have an obligation. We all are a royal priesthood. So it is all of our obligation to preach the word, whatever little word that you know. If you only know John 3:16, that's what you preach. If you only know what you've experienced, that's what you preached. Don't preach something someone else did. Preach you. That's why whenever I do my sermons, they're always so personal, because that's me. That's my experience. You can't deny my experience. You can't tell me that, oh, you don't know who Jesus Christ is. Are you sure? I know who Jesus Christ is. I met him myself. He called me. You can't tell me he didn't call me. So we have to have that same mindset. We have to have that same mindset where you take whatever you have in your pocket, and that's what you bring. You bring that to the table. Because God has given you life experience. God has saved you and brought you out of a place where you don't want to be anymore. That's why you're here. And those of you that are still seeking and trying to understand, that's
why you're here. Amen? All right, before I get out of my slides. Now, the mission isn't the same for everybody. Okay? My mission is not Pastor Steve's mission. My mission, you know, Mark was like, babe, we're going to Thailand. I said, okay, we're going to Thailand. Pastor D, we're going to go to Thailand. Pastor D's like, praise the Lord, you're going to Thailand. We need one more man to go to Thailand with us. Right? He remembers. But I prayed for myself. Because sometimes we have to pray for ourselves. We got to speak to God for ourselves to help him, to help us identify what God wants for us to do. No one's mission is the same. Maybe your mission is to talk to your cousin or your brother or your mother about who Jesus Christ is. That probably is not my mission. Okay? Maybe you have been given a gift to do and serve food. And through that gift of hospitality, you show the love of Christ to people that are coming in here. We have to be cognizant of what our mission is. Because it's not the same for everybody. How I reach someone is not the same way that you're going to reach somebody. Because God has given all of us different gifts. Amen? Oh, one more thing that we have to, what we see here, is part of Paul's gift was that he needed to bring up and mature other believers. And so what he was doing here, by taking Timothy, who's this young man, taking Timothy with him, he was showing him the ropes. This is the churches that I started, and I want you to come with me so you can learn and you can see what it's like out there. You can see the persecution that we're going to face. You can see and hear all the negativity that's going on. This is what we do here at New Creation. It's called leadership development. That's what Paul was doing for Timothy. And so for some of us, raise your hand if you've been Christian for a long time. Go ahead, don't be shy. Okay, all of you raising your hand. This is your obligation to mentor someone else so that when you go, someone can take your place and continue on the work that God has for this church. Amen? Amen. When Pastor D and the whole team leaves, this church doesn't stop. We still keep going. Amen? When I meet the Lord, someone should be able to take my spot. So, we all have this obligation to reach out to somebody and train up a new person because maybe that's your mission. Maybe you're training up the next Paul. Maybe you're training up the next Martin Luther King. You never know. Because all the little stuff that God has told you to do, they amount to something. And you might not see what that is. We talked about this in Sunday school. We should have been in Sunday school. That sometimes you don't necessarily see the big picture. And so God has given you, has pierced your heart. I know it. I know God has convicted some of you guys. Right now, I can feel it, that in your heart, you have a mission that you need to do. Maybe it's a child that you have that's wayward. Maybe it's somebody that you need to talk to and just talk about your experience with Christ. Because those little seeds that you end up planting can grow, can change your life. You never know.
When Mara and I had, when we were dating, one of our friends gave us a book. And it was called The Purpose-Driven Life. And we would just read it together. And it changed our lives. It really did. That little seed, and we barely ever talked to this guy who, you know, one of her brother's friends, they gave us this book. We barely ever talked to him. But imagine from that small little, like, here, take this, read it. To me, being up here is unfathomable. I would have never thought this. I would never wanted it for myself either. But that is real talk. Real talk. I was, you know, driving in just like 30 minutes ago. So, but we all have God. If God calls you, are you just going to ignore the path that he's laid before you? And sometimes he closes that door because you had an idea of this is what I'm going to do. And just like Paul, you're going to be met with frustration. You're going to be met with, oh, I can't go there. You're going to be met with, oh, I don't have the words to speak. Well, maybe that's not the place where you should be at. And so Paul was given a different mission. Amen? All right. And that is our second point. We need to be sensitive to the Spirit of God. We got to pay attention to the Spirit. You know, every morning when I wake up, we wake up around 5 o'clock in the morning, and it's like a mad rush to get ready because I have to get the boys ready, you got to make lunches, we have to get dressed, and then we make our long commute all the way down to Henderson because we live up here in Aliante. And so, I don't know if you've been on the 95 lately, it is a mess. And so, you know, I've been doing this drive for 13 years now. And so it's kind of like automatic. This is the way I'm going to go. I still once in a while put on my navigation on my iPhone because, you know, sometimes there's traffic and I don't know about it. And, you know, sometimes there's police and I don't know about it. And so sometimes it takes me some random place and, you know, like, if I'm listening to music, I might just ignore where I'm, because I know where I'm going, so I just go. This one time I was driving, and it's like, we're at the Spaghetti Bowl, and it says, you know, oh, exit at, you know, the Fremont Street downtown area. I was like, what? Why am I going to exit here? This is crazy. And so I was like, ah, forget this. I'm going to do my own thing. And so I keep going straight. You know, the drive is already 45 minutes. Another 45 minutes later, I got to work. I was late. I had a call. I'm like, hey, I don't know what's going on. I'm in standstill traffic. This is crazy. And so now I realize that sometimes I got to listen to whatever it's saying on here. You know, and like every morning it's different. It's like, oh, this, like, because Mara and I will go the same way. And she's like, where are you going? I'm like, it's telling me to go to Summerlin to get to Henderson. I don't know. But I'm going to do it because there's probably no better way than that way. See, in Acts, we see the same thing. Okay? Paul was met with frustration. And Paul was met with, you don't go there. And so Paul was given a vision to go to Macedonia. This is the new place I want you to go. Because sometimes in our mind we have a fixed place that we're supposed to do because we're comfortable with that. This is what we're, you know, yeah, I'm going to be myself. I'm going to shine light at work, but maybe this day God wants you to go to a different place and be the light somewhere else. Okay, and so that's what was happening with Paul and Silas and Timothy, was that Paul had an agenda, and you know, he was, if you look at his first missionary journey, he was met with a lot of disappointment. He was stoned, you know, and almost died. And Paul was like, you know, I'm used to this. I'm just going to keep trying and doing what I'm doing. But God, sometimes we have to be cognizant of what God wants for us. Because maybe there's an easier route. It might be not necessarily easier, but I got a different route for you. Okay? And so, because of his obedience, what we see here is he moves on to Macedonia. And where he moves on to is the gateway. They call this the gateway to Europe. So this singular event where he decided to follow God's obedience allowed him to minister the gospel to Europe. And this singular event, a lot of scholars think that this is how Christianity spread to Europe, because of Timothy's work here when he decided to obey God with this Macedonian call. And so, because of what he did, and because he answered the call, we have the Corinthian church, we have the Philippian church, we have the Thessalonian church, and then we have a lot of this. If it had not been for Paul listening to God, we would not have a lot of this New Testament that we read today. Amen? So the question is, how are we supposed to be sensitive to the Spirit? You know, God, you know, people always say, oh, you got to listen to what the Spirit says. Well, how are we supposed to be listening to the Spirit? Well, it's here, Ephesians 5:18. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. This last part is what you guys want to take note of. Be filled with the Spirit. You need to fill yourself with the Spirit. You can't fill yourself with the Spirit if your heart and your soul is full with other stuff. You got to empty all of that out. You can't be filled with the Spirit if your soul desires carnality. If your soul wants to be fleshy and do all the sinful things. You can't be filled with the Spirit if you don't desire the Spirit. You can't be filled with the Spirit if you allow yourselves to be slaves to your sinful desires. How can you hear the directions when everything that's coming into your eyes and into your ears is sinful? How can you know that what God wants for you when you haven't even opened the directions? How can you know what God wants for you if you haven't sat down and prayed and listened? Because that's where we see God is, right? We got to seek God. If you want to be filled with the Spirit, don't fill yourself up with nonsense, with gossip, with talebearing, with anger, with lust, with sinful desire. Fill yourself up with the good word. Fill yourself up with praise. Pray to God. Seek Him. Amen? If you want the Holy Spirit to speak to you, speak to Him. Desire Him. Seek Him. If you want to go God's way, follow Jesus. Do what Jesus did. Crucify your flesh. You know, if you want to follow Jesus, do that. Do this. Do this. Because it's not about us. If you think about it, Jesus didn't come down for himself. He came down for us. So offer yourselves. Romans 12:1 says offer. Is it on here? No, it's not. Romans 12:1 says offer yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. It is not my will, but your God, but it is not my will, God, but your will be done. Do the Bible. Do the Bible. Do the Bible.
As you do the Bible, you'll begin to realize the Bible is not about you. Your life's purpose is not about you. Each one of us that accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior and we desire to follow him, you all have been called to do what God wants. Amen? 2 Peter 1:3-9 says, His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us very great and precious promises so that through them, you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption of this world caused by evil desires. For this reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed for their past sins. This is the blueprint, folks. If you want discernment in your life, you do the godly things in your life. You speak to him regularly. You'll hear God speaking through your thoughts. He'll use ordinary practices such as reading the Bible, praying quietly, learning from your circumstances, and seeking counsel from other Christians to reach out. And God might use dramatic means to speak to you, but more than often, if we pay attention, he'll use your inner small voice to talk to you and tell you where to go. Tell you what to do. But you can't do this unless you grow in Christ. If the only thing that you have is John 3:16 and that's all you have, that's great, but it could be better. If you want a spirit-filled life, go take the spirit-filled life class that's happening in May. I got you. If you don't know what your spiritual gift is, take the shape class. That's happening in May. There is no reason why you can't do the Bible. You have no excuses because the path is laid out for you here at New Creation Outreach Ministries. And if you don't want to do it here, go find it. Or else you don't want to do the Bible. And just be real with yourself. Amen? All right. Lastly, obedience leads to harvest. When we're obedient to God, it doesn't mean that everything will be easy. The Bible is littered with hardships, right? Paul, if you read on after Paul is with Lydia, he gets thrown into prison for doing good deeds by freeing a woman of an evil spirit. And so he gets put into prison, and what he does is that even in the midst of his circumstance, he's able to sing hymns and find the joy in the situation. Even through difficult circumstances, he's going to praise God anyway. See, sometimes we're in these difficult circumstances and we got to put our praise on it. We got to know that God is still with us and that God is still in control. Even when we can't eat the food where we're going, God is still in control. It's not going to be easy, but God is still in control. We can still praise God anyway. And when people see that you're praising through your storm, what happened to Paul? We know that all those people saw him praising.
and heard him praise, and the jailer was like, oh my gosh. You know, they got released. They miraculously all got released. I'm going to kill myself. Yeah. Who goes there? So like, I'm just going to kill myself. But he's probably suffering through something. Right? And what happens is that, no, we're still here. Don't worry. Don't kill yourself. And who gets saved? The jailer gets saved. And even his entire family gets saved. See, even though it's not going to be easy for our missionaries to communicate with these folks in Thailand, I'm sure these little seeds are going to be planted as they go, wherever they go. You know, I was so like, you know, wherever we go, we should be planting these seeds, right? On Friday, if you missed a couple's ministry, you missed a great time. It was great. But you know what was even better? Was that Talanda was ministering to someone there at one of our cooks. He was doing the whole Benihana thing. And was like, hey, you should come to our church. That's how we should be when we're out there. And he's like, yeah, I'll come to your church. That sounds good. You know, he's not here today, but hopefully he will be here. But don't discount small beginnings. Okay? You got to start somewhere. You got to start somewhere. We've all been set apart to do great work. You know, this is the first, they call him the first missionary, William Carey. And William Carey, he had a meager beginning. Okay? He only had an elementary school education. And he was supposed to be a cordwainer, which is like a shoemaker. And through just listening to the word, he was saved. And then when he was saved, he realized he had a hunger for education. And so he taught himself all these different languages. He taught himself Greek in like 3 weeks. No, he taught himself Latin in 6 weeks. Then he taught himself French and Greek in like 3 weeks. Because God gave him a gift. And so he felt convicted. He's like, you know what? I need to go share the word with people who don't know Jesus Christ. And so in the 1700s, like late 1700s, he ends up taking a boat to India. And goes to India. And on the way from India, he learns Bengali, which is the language that where he was going to. It was just Bengal. Isn't that amazing? And so on his way to where he was going, he decides to translate the book of Genesis into Bengali. And so he takes it. So when he's there, he's prepared to go speak to the people who need Jesus Christ. And so when he gets there, well, on his way there, he's like, you know what? He's talking to a friend and he's like, if I get there, what happens if they tell me to go back? If the company, the East India Company decides that I shouldn't stay here and that I should go back home. And his friend says, you know what? If that's the case, then the Lord hasn't sent you there. The Lord has nothing for you to accomplish there. And this is something that really moved him. He said, but if he have, no power on earth can stop you. And we should have that same mindset. If God gives you a mission to do, no power on earth can stop you from doing that mission. I mean, I think about Jonas. No power on earth can stop what God wanted Jonas to do. Not even Jonas himself. And so what happened with William Carey was that while he was there, he ends up translating all like these different languages that are local to the area into the Bible, and he makes a Sanskrit dictionary and a Bengali dictionary, and he the invention of the print press was around this time too, so he's able to print all this stuff. And then catastrophe happens. A fire breaks out. All the volumes of his work that he had been doing for years, like that. 1,200 reams of paper, it says, that just went up into flames. But he's like, you know what? If God has put me here to do this, I'm going to continue doing that. And so he did. And in 20 years, they were able to publish the Bible in 44 different local languages. There's a university there that's still there today that was started because of him. This is George Lyle. Does anyone know who George Lyle is? This man was a little bit before William Carey. He was born into slavery. And one day he heard the gospel, and his life was changed when he heard the gospel. Much like all of us, our life was changed when we heard the gospel. And then he realized that he needed to share the gospel with other people. And so he started preaching. He first started preaching in the white churches. And he wanted to preach to all the slaves that were around his area. He was in the South. And so he decides, he keeps doing what he's doing, and his owner was so enthralled by his preaching, was like, you know what? I'm going to set you free. And so you could continue preaching the gospel to all these people. His owner was a loyalist, and so during the American Revolution, they saw him and were like, no, you're a slave, and tried to put him back into slavery. I skipped the part where he started two churches in the South. Those two churches are still there today. But as a slave who had no formal education, it's amazing what God can do if he wants to use you. Because what happens to him was that because they want to put him back in slavery, he's like, you know, I need to get out of here. I'm going to get out of here. And so he puts himself back into indentured service. What that is that I'm going to pay for your ticket, but you have to work for me for free for about 5 to 7 years. And so he decides, you know, I don't want to be back here in slavery in America. I'm going to leave. I'm going to take my stuff and go to Jamaica, which is still an English colony. But in Jamaica, as an English colony, they don't have religious freedom there because the Church of England controls all the churches. And so it was illegal for him to preach to the slaves, because that's who he wanted to preach to, was the slaves that were working in Jamaica. But you know what? He said, I'm going to do it anyway. So they put him in prison. And then they finally let him free, but he still continues to do his work. He starts a church, but he's preaching to slaves, so he doesn't have a lot of money to pay for his stuff. They put him to prison again because he can't pay for his building, a debtor's prison. But that didn't stop him from preaching the gospel and doing the work. And so, because of what he did and what he started in Jamaica, 8,000 people were saved from his work. He ends up sending, their churches send up missionaries to West Africa. And he is really the first missionary, even before William Carey was a missionary. And that's what we have to realize, is if God has given us something to do, regardless if it's just visiting some folks, spending a couple weeks in prisons to talk to people, Imagine the work that we can do, that God can do through us. Because we don't know that what we say to somebody, sharing the love of Christ to someone, what that can turn into. At least if one person is saved on this mission trip, it's a successful mission trip. Amen. And so, I would like to call on our mission team, and we're going to pray over the mission team. We're going to pray for their success and their safety. We know that this is hard stuff. This is a hard thing to do, to go to a place that's unknown. None of us speak the language. None of the team speaks the language. My wife is allergic to garlic. Everything in Thai food is garlic. But that's not going to stop my wife from going because she was given a job to do. I'm not going to stop my wife from going because she was given a job to do. So we're going to get the team out here. We're going to have the ministers come up and lay hands on the team and pray over them.